Text Ken now, 53958. Text cost 20 cents.
Well, it's the last week of July 2013, but on the last day of July in 1975, one of the most horrible atrocities of the Troubles occurred when a UVF gang shot dead three members of the Miami Show Band at Busk Hill, just outside Newry. Now, it's bad enough that a non-sectarian entertainment act should have been subjected to such an attack, but what makes this particular massacre all the more controversial is the strong belief that the British Army facilitated the attack. Well, 38 years on, the survivors are still looking for answers, and I believe things are about to move up a notch in the search for the truth. Well, to find out more, I'm joined on the line by Stephen Travers, one of the survivors of the massacre. Stephen, can I begin by asking you, just very briefly, just talk us through the events of the night.
Good morning, Ken. Basically, as you said, we were a popular, what today you'd probably call a pop band or a rock band. And on our way home from the from an engagement in Banbridge, we were stopped by stopped at a checkpoint. And during the interrogation, while we were on the road with our hands on our heads, looking into a field, they were secretly planting a bomb underneath the driver's seat in the van. And I should stress that we were a mixed band insofar as we were Catholics and Protestants and Northerners and Southerners. So they had intended to send us on our way, say thanks very much for your cooperation. It would have blown up, killed all the members of the band. Nobody would have known anything about the roadblock, and we would have been framed as terrorists or being in league with terrorists. But unfortunately for them, bomb went off unexpectedly, prematurely, and killed the two men planting the bomb, and so they proceeded then to murder the rest of the band. But two of us, happily, we survived it.
Well, can I ask you, why do you think you were targeted?
Well, for a long time, I thought that we were undoing the work of the terrorists, but I could never really reconcile that with the idea that the British Army and the British security forces would be involved. So I now know that there was great concern on the part of the British that there was very little security once you crossed back down into the south. Insofar as that when you went into the north, you were usually stopped very quickly by checkpoints and army and UDR police. But on the way back down, it was pretty clear run. So they wanted to force the Irish government into having a stop and search of everybody in the Republic. And you can imagine the trouble that would have caused in the area, up in the area that you are now, where somebody going up to do shopping or to get petrol or whatever would have been stopped and searched every time. But so in order to force the Irish government to stop and search everybody, they decided that they would frame and make the most innocent objective. Then they would have said, if you can't trust a show band, a pop group, who can you trust? So there'd be no excuse for the stop and search.
Okay, now there was the OUC investigation, and as time moved on, you became very conscious of what was known as the shoot-to-kill policy in the north, and then there was the historical inquiries team inquiry, and then there was the Justice for the Forgotten dealing with the Dublin-Monaghan bombings. You're of the belief that the British Army colluded with the UVF in the atrocity. What can you tell us?
Well, I have no doubt about that. But first of all, if you can, people often forget that the UDR was the biggest regiment in the British Army. The evidence of my own eyes and ears, I saw a British Army officer at the scene. He took control, he took charge when he arrived, and he gave directions and even changed one of the orders. So I have no doubt whatsoever. Also, I didn't see anything unusual about that, being a novice with regard to going up and down. But when it came almost a year later for the preliminary trials, I mentioned to the prosecution, these people on our side supposedly, that the presence of this officer, and I was told that it wasn't important. Even then it didn't occur to me that there was a cover-up taking place, but there certainly was. There was a cover-up all the time.
Well, now, 38 years on, there's been a book, there's talk of a movie. I understand there's been a development in the last number of weeks in terms of seeking the truth.
Well, there has, Ken. We have issued a writ and we've submitted our statement of claim. We're basically taking the Ministry of Defence, the British Ministry of Defence, and the Chief Constable of the Police Service of Northern Ireland. We're taking them to court and we're for their direct complicity in the murder of the Miami Show Band and my attempted murder, and of course Dez's as well.
And how soon do you think that'll get to the courts?
Sooner the better. Sooner the better. They have a lot of. The evidence is overwhelming. I mean, can you imagine? I mean, obviously we found documents under the Freedom of Information, but with this particular process, we'll also have discovery. So we'll be able to demand. But I was just looking at a document yesterday. And can you imagine this, that there was a directive given out from the very top, from the very top, I'm talking about Stormont, the Secretary of State, everybody who is party to this, and I'll read it for you. I should stress that under these, this was when they decided to include the UDR in intelligence gathering. And it says here, I should stress that under these proposals, the UDR's collection role will be directed at intelligence on terrorist activities. There is no intention of recruiting or encouraging members of the UDR to become informers on subversive elements within the UDR, although, as you know, subversion in the UDR is a cause for concern. Both the GOC and Commander UDR would be strongly averse to any proposal to task members of the UDR in this way. Basically, they're saying if a member of the UDR finds out or discovers that one of his colleagues in the UDR is a subversive or is involved in terrorism, he is definitely not to tell on him. Can you imagine a civilized government issuing such a directive? It's a scandal. I never thought that I'd end up in my life on radio and television going around Europe to universities talking about this subject, but it's been forced on me now, so I will see it through.
Okay, Stephen, very briefly, and we're up against the clock here, I believe plans are in the pipeline for a movie.
Yes, they are. There's a film being made. We would have finished it a long time ago, but because of the ongoing revelations and that, we've delayed it and we haven't finished the screenplay. But that should be very interesting. Before I go, I'd just like to thank Margaret Orwin, an absolute diamond in Justice for the Forgotten, and also all those in Pat Finucane Centre for all their help on this.
OK, well, look, Stephen, thank you very much indeed for taking our call this morning and the best of luck with that. And as I said, next Thursday is the 31st of July. It marks the 38th anniversary of the Miami Show Band massacre. But Stephen took our call today as he has other commitments out of the country next week.